I can't fly.
What?
You heard me. I can't fly.
No. You're going to have to do better than that, pal.
No, I don't have to do better than that because it's the truth. I can't fly. I suffer from aviophobia.
What does that mean?
It means I can't fly. I also suffer from acrophobia and claustrophobia.
Well, I'll tell you what. If you don't cooperate, you're going to suffer from fistophobia.
Travel back in time to the 80s. Reliving the music.
Everybody, have fun tonight. Everybody, Wang Chung tonight.
The movies.
Yes! 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 Oh! Oh! Oh!
I'll have what she's having.
And the parties.
No one in my family ever drinks.
That's great! You probably never run out of ice your whole life.
Because just like you, we're stuck in the 80s.
Sure, it's not 1985 right now, but who knows what tomorrow will bring.
Hey, welcome to Stuck in the 80s. It's your host, Steve Spears.
And Brad in L.A.
And today, we head out on our own version of planes, trains, automobiles, and bail bondsmen to celebrate the 30th anniversary of the movie Midnight Run.
Is this moron number one? Put moron number two on the phone.
Steve, Stuck in the 80s is a member of the CLNS Podcast Network. In the off chance you'd forgotten, you can find our podcasts on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify, and the CLNS Media mobile app.
And let's say it all together. Don't forget to listen to our podcast at the CLNS Media website. You can find it at where? Where?
It's at clnsmedia.com, Steve.
Like, if we mix it up, people actually pay attention. But what do I do now, Brad?
You beg, you plead, you badger, you harangue.
Yes.
It's a loving harangue, though. Not at all harsh.
Not a lemon harangue.
Mm.
Don't forget to like our page on Facebook. The address is facebook.com/stuckinthe80s podcast, or follow us on Twitter. It's just simply Stuck in the 80s. And remember, all our shows.
If you want to follow me on Twitter, it's Brad in the 80s.
cricket.
It's mostly soccer crap, let's face it.
And as always, our main website is still, and always will be, at least until the next podcast, SIT80s.com.
Steve, joining us today is Just Drew, and if I'm not mistaken, he sounds like a man with some news to share. Drew, what's going on?
Well, guys, you know, I'm not comfortable on planes. I don't like to fly. I'm not good at flying.
These things go down. All right, these things go down. They go. It's too big. It can't go up.
But the news I have, Steve, is that my wife and I will be joining all of you on the 80s cruise.
Oh my God!
In 2019.
You shifty little bastard! I asked you, like, we just.
We just talked about it, and I lied. I lied to you because I wanted to surprise
man.
You on air.
Oh, that's so good. I'm so happy.
I can hear you smiling from here.
I am. It's like it hurts. Yep. My face hasn't exercised these muscles in months, so I don't know what to do.
Yeah, so we're going to be joining you, Brad, Just Jen, Jennifer, who I met at Disneyland. I mean, everybody's going to be there. So be there, Bet. Everybody.
All the humans. The Ramoses.
Everybody. So we're going to have a good time.
We officially need more than one table now. So
no.
The nerds, the dorks, the dweebs, the sportos.
Bloods.
Fun.
Geeks. Actually, one of my high school friends from Oklahoma and his wife are coming too.
Yeah. Oh, right.
Getting the band back together.
I don't have any friends, like, outside of, like, the Stuck in 80s friends that would let her go. No. I have friends, but none of them ever want to come on the cruise. I don't know what's up with that. My friends are.
But your friends are coming on the cruise.
I'm just saying, my non-podcast family, you know.
What is that? I don't even know what that means anymore.
You know, to be honest, I don't even know if they exist. So let's leave it at that.
I say now my podcast family is some of my favorite family.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Find out why. Come along with us.
Yeah.
In the meantime, we have some business at hand. Midnight Run has just hit its 30th anniversary. It was released on July 20th, 1988. The movie starred Robert De Niro as a bounty hunter who has to track down an accountant for the Chicago mob, played by Charles Grodin, who is running for his life after embezzling $15 million and skipping out on his bail. De Niro has 5 days to bring back Grodin before the bail expires. In the meantime, they're being pursued by the FBI, some tough guys from the mob, all of them wanting the wayward accountant at any cost. Sound like a compelling, gritty drama? Well, it is, but it's also one of the funniest movies from the second half of the 80s, and that's probably why we still love it today. Either one of you guys see this one in the theater?
No, sir.
Yeah, I saw it in theaters, and I remember seeing it with my dad.
Oh.
And we laughed our asses off. This is one of our favorite films.
Yeah, nice.
I saw it with the girlfriend known as Lasangerie Girl.
Lasangerie Girl rears her ugly head. I'm sure it was a lovely, yeah. Never mind.
That's such a weird picture I get in my head of, what was she wearing?
Well, for those who are new.
What was she eating, for that matter?
For those who are new to the podcast, Lasangerie Girl, a term coined by a gentleman with one N, is the amalgam that we have invented for the girl previously known as Lingerie Girl or Lasagna Girl.
Depending on what Steve is thinking about, food or... You know,
because I bought her a pair of peach colored lingerie from JCPenney's when she came to pick up that.
So wrong.
Well, I was 19 years old, but we did it for 2 years. But the last year, which is probably 1988, was very rocky for us.
Okay.
And we went to see this movie, and I'm pretty sure we saw it in Winter Haven, Florida, which is like this little burg. Halfway between Tampa and Orlando. It's a spot on the map. But that's where she was from. We went to see it.
Okay.
And we got in some argument. And she threw me out of her car and it was raining.
Like while driving? Like showed you out the door?
Yes. No, well she stopped. She stopped on the street.
Did at least slow down.
Told me to get out of the car. And so I walked back from where I was to her house in the rain.
Sorry, I'm laughing at that.
Where my car was waiting, and I'm like, that's it. This relationship's over. I'm out of here. So I'm trying to get into my car to drive back to Gainesville, and her parents come running out, and they're all apologetic and saying, don't leave. She's real sorry. She's in there crying because she knows she did the wrong thing.
Oh, boy.
Come in there and at least let her apologize. God. And you should, I mean, can't drive home to Gainesville at 10 o'clock at night in a driving rainstorm. So I go inside and she's not sorry. She's still
pissed. She's like, what are you doing here?
Somehow I've been conned by her parents. Anyway, I think we survived like 1 or 2 months after this. So when I think of Midnight Run, I think of the drive that I should have made, the Midnight Run that I should have made from Winter Haven to Gainesville. And alas, there was no embezzled $15 million or mob guys coming after me, but it might as well have been for his.
I'm picturing you tumbling out of the passenger seat like those guys tumble out of the boxcar at that one point of the movie.
She had one of those cars. Like,
the middle eating a banana.
Remember those cheap-ass cars that they had in the 80s that they came out and they were stripped down? They had like nothing in them. They were like...
Like a
Yugo.
Like a Hyundai, like an early Hyundai or a Yugo. Yeah.
Like a Yugo. I don't think it was a Yugo. But it literally felt like a halfway made Yugo. And that was like the little something.
Yeah, no.
Like
Geo Metro?
That would have been a limo Geo Metro? I just remember like the humiliation of getting kicked out of the world's worst car. Oh, this horrible little hamlet in the backwater Florida. So when you suggested doing this topic this week, I was naturally...
Now I understand why you're pushing back a little bit.
Yeah. Which sucks for me because I love this film. I love this film.
What do you love about it?
Here's what I love about it. It's like literally everything you'd want in an action film, in a buddy film, in a, you know, a not buddy film. It's like 48 hours where they're not buddies. You've got chase scenes. You've got action. You've got drama. You've got all this stuff and it all wraps up so nicely. And, you know, how many action films can you think of that end on such a sweet moment of him telling him good luck and saying goodbye and letting him off? And having that moment of really kind of a nice touching moment is a great way to end the film. You know, looks like I'm walking, yeah. which I guess is what you said after you got shoved out of the car.
Yeah. Wow. I didn't make the connection.
I just figured it was a riff on I'm walking here.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's actually interesting. When he walks up to the taxi driver guy and he says, can you break 1,000? Yeah, the taxi driver goes, get out of here. He actually worked with De Niro on Taxi Driver.
That's funny.
Funny.
So bit of trivia there. That's why I love the film, is just because it has so many elements of every one of those different genres of films. And yet it does a great job of combining them all together. I'm surprised. I was really surprised when I watched it again yesterday. I was like, God, I didn't realize it was that long. It's like 2 hours long.
It's a bit of a slog through the middle, but then it kind of tips over and it starts going again.
Yeah. But that's the thing, is so I started deconstructing it a little bit, going, okay, what would I take out if I, and all of those scenes really play well off of one another. And there's really nothing that you could shorten that would, you know, make it go maybe a little faster in a couple places.
It's pretty economical, though. There's not a lot of fat in there. You're right.
Yeah.
So I saw it for the first time last night. I'd never seen this movie.
No, really? Yeah.
I've never seen this movie. And this is something we talk about doing sometimes, like the let's do a podcast about a movie everybody loves, but you've never seen. And, you know, so that's kind of what this can be a little bit about. It shouldn't all be about that. But I really enjoyed it. I didn't really know what to expect, except that Drew is singing its praises and Steve is mildly reluctant to talk about it due to due to walking situation,
extenuating
circumstances, as we like to say. But I enjoyed it. It starts up and I'm like, oh my gosh, Robert De Niro looks so young. I'm like, okay, yeah. I had to look it up. I'm like, okay, he was 45. He looks great for 45.
Yeah, no kidding.
But yeah, I really enjoyed it. The characters are good, and like you say, it's kind of this, are they friends? Are they enemies? Are they, you know, they're just kind of thrown together out of circumstance. There's a point late in the movie where one of them says, you know, in different circumstances, we still would have hated each other. I thought that was great.
Why would you eat that?
Why? Because it tastes good.
But it's not good for you.
I'm aware of that.
Well, why would you do something that you know that's not good for you?
Because I don't think about it.
Well, that's living in denial.
Living in denial?
Yeah.
I'm aware of that.
So you're aware of all your behavior, yet you continue to do things that aren't good for you. That sounds sort of foolish, don't you think so, Jack?
No. Stealing $15 million from Jimmy Serrano sounds foolish.
I don't think I'd get caught.
Now that's living in denial.
I'm aware of that.
Oh, so you're aware of your behavior, and yet you continue to do things that aren't good for you. Sounds kind of foolish to me, don't you think, John?
It was foolish.
You know what I think is interesting about this movie? De Niro sought this movie out as a project because he wanted to take a break from the kind of roles he'd been doing up until that point. He just finished Untouchables. Mm-hmm. And he did a lot of heavy movies to this point in his career. And he wanted a comic role. He actually tried to get a part in the movie Big, which we talked about.
Oh, which we just talked about. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But that didn't happen because I think it was his salary demand was a little ridiculous. And so we landed here instead. He was like the no-brainer. The studio was more than happy to have De Niro in there. But Charles Grodin, on the other hand, not anybody's first pick.
No. Such good casting, though. Such good casting.
Yeah, that's the thing, is in the end, it had such good casting. But, man, basically every leading man in Hollywood was talked about the role. I mean, you had, there for a while, actually for one moment, there was Stallone and Schwarzenegger in both the roles, the Duke and Jack Walsh. Huh. But that kind of fell apart. And then they decided maybe Stallone or Schwarzenegger, one of those guys, could play the Duke. But, you know, it would have been a vastly different, and I may say, an inferior film with one of those guys in that role.
Grodin is so good as the accountant. I mean, he's just such a, you know, he's barely even there. And then he says something like, yeah, that's what an accountant would say.
I have to tell you, a restaurant is a very tricky investment. More than half of them go under within the first 6 months. If I were your accountant, I'd have to strongly advise you against it. No, I'm just saying that it's a very, very tricky business. And if I were your accountant, I would really strongly have to advise you against it as an accountant.
I've never seen chemistry like that. And that's what eventually sold the studio. The studio, they talked about Cher doing it so that, you know, you could add a little extra spice to it.
Ooh.
They talked about Robin Williams, who really wanted the part. Ultimately, they got Grodin and De Niro in the same room and did an audition, and it was obvious. Boom, they said. That's what I've heard anyway. Just obvious right then and there that that's what it was going to make work.
Nice.
What worked for them also was that they were all repped by the same agency. That's why Grodin kind of got his foot in the door.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
Yeah, because originally, like you said, it was Robin Williams and stuff like that. And then he had to pass. I can't remember why. And so then Paramount, which had the film, decided to give it to, was it Universal? I think it's Universal.
Yeah, it's a Universal movie.
And so that's why they ended up switching, and Grodin and Brest and De Niro were all repped by the same agency. So that's how that all kind of came together. But yeah, it was perfect. I mean, I don't think any of them realized just how good the chemistry was going to be between those two guys.
Let me see if I can stump you guys with a quickie trivia question here. Between De Niro and Charles Grodin, who do you think had more film credits in the 80s?
Oh, gosh.
I would say De Niro.
Yeah, he did a lot of work.
And how much?
So that's probably not the answer if you're asking us, because that seems like the obvious answer.
And how many movies do you think De Niro did in the 80s? Was it like more than 6, less than 6, more than 10, less than 10?
I would say 10 or 12.
Yeah, because I remember he was also doing a lot of cameos. That was one of the reasons I saw when I was looking at this film, is that I found an interview with De Niro from 88 in Rolling Stones talking about this film, and he said absolutely nothing. He's the worst interview. He just doesn't really want to talk about anything.
He doesn't open up at all.
But he said something about having done a few cameos. So yeah, I would have to say it's 10 or more.
Yeah.
The correct answer is 12. He did 12 movies.
Oh, all right.
Starting with Raging Bull and ending with We're No Angels.
There's a real plum on his resume.
Yeah, we will not be talking about that on the podcast anytime soon. Charles Grodin, 12 movies in the 80s.
Huh.
Whoa.
Interesting.
Starting with It's My Turn and ending with Midnight Run.
Huh.
The ones that you would kind of maybe remember, these are not well-known movies, but for the ones you probably do remember, Seems Like Old Times.
Sure.
The Great Muppet Caper. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know he was in that.
The Lonely Guy.
Oh, well, of course. That I remember.
Yeah.
And The Couch Trip with him and Danny. Oh. So those are the big ones.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of Grodin. I mean, this is probably my favorite role of his. I think the only other film I could say that I really liked him in was Heaven Can Wait.
Oh, he's fantastic.
That was really it. He just always seems to bother me. I think because he's really understated.
Yeah.
But I loved him in this role. I thought he was just the perfect nebbishy, annoying guy.
That's the exact word. He's perfect in this role. And they hit the right spot with that. They got the right note out of him.
Well, critics generally agreed. Midnight Run has a 96% fresh rating at Rotten Tomatoes based on 45 reviews. The stuck in the 80s favorite.
Not nearly enough reviews.
Film critic Roger Ebert, the late Roger Ebert, gave the film 3.5 out of 4 stars and wrote, quote, "What Midnight Run does with these two characters is astonishing because it's accomplished within the structure of a comic thriller. It's rare for a thriller to end with a scene of genuinely moving intimacy, but this one does and it earns it." Unquote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the scene where he also goes to see his daughter.
Oh, yeah. Let's talk about that. Oh, my gosh.
Wait. Isn't much. About $180 babysitting money.
Oh, sweetheart, I can't. I can't.
Please.
I can't, sweetheart.
That's just heartbreaking.
Yeah.
And she tries to give him the money as she's, you know, her babysitting money. And he's, you know, I couldn't remember when I saw the scene as he's leaving, if he took the money or not. And I was really torn because I knew that if he got the money, he would pay her back. But at the same time, I'm like, you can't take that money. You cannot take that money from
Brad, her. You watched it last night. Did he take the money? I want to say he does.
No, he says he can't. He says he can't. And then, I mean, you don't see him like shove it away. You don't like, I mean, his hands are away from you. So maybe he says though while he's pocketing it. But yeah, that scene, I do want to talk about that because I think that scene kind of makes this movie something different because you get this moment where if you just watch this, you probably remember this too, Drew, is De Niro's character. He is so lost when he's standing in the house, like waiting, he's talking to his ex-wife and they're kind of getting into it a little bit. And he's like, oh, wait, okay. And then his daughter comes in and he looks just adrift. Like he doesn't know what to say. Yeah. He doesn't know what to do. And it just, oh my gosh. I'm like, as I watch these movies, I'm like sitting here typing notes to myself on my phone so I can remember things. And here's what I wrote at that moment. I wrote, oh shit, the daughter appears. And this is where Brad loses it. Niro looks so lost. Because I was just like, oh my gosh. I mean, you know, I'm sure in 1988, I would have been like, oh, he's got a daughter. That's interesting. But now I have a daughter,
yeah.
You know, and I'm trying, yeah. You put yourself in that position where it's like, here's this kid, not a kid, eighth grader that you haven't seen in how long was it? 6 years, 8 years, 9 years? I don't remember.
9 years.
9 years. Oh my gosh. It's just, oh, I mean, it's a bit of a cheap shot, maybe, you know, just a little emotional note that you can lay on a parent, but
here's what makes it so interesting.
That's a good thing.
Here's what makes it so interesting. He is a former Chicago policeman who refused to go on the take with the mob.
Right.
He was like the one clean cop in Chicago. And he basically gets chased out of town for it. His wife goes on and marries a corrupt cop. And he's the bad guy.
Yep.
He's the bad guy.
Yeah.
He's standing there looking awkward. Right. And he ought to be standing. I mean, that's what's so brilliant about that scene. Is that it's all flipped around on its head.
In the end, he knows that he's the bad guy because he hasn't seen his daughter in 9 years.
Right.
He's kind of abandoned them.
Yeah. It's complicated.
It's complicated, but when he just sees her, oh man, it's just with Grodin kind of in the background, just kind of mugging, kind of.
Yeah. And then then he's like, oh, I should look away now. And
yeah.
And that's just one of the things about the film that makes it so different from everything else. It's not just a chase film. It's not just a buddy film. There's a lot of heart to it.
Yeah. When I saw that Farina was in it, I just assumed he was going to be a cop.
No.
And then he shows up as the mobster, and I'm like, oh, yeah, that's spot on, too. Yeah. And he's really good in that role. I just figured he was going to be, you know, hard-boiled police detective number 27.
No. Fantastic.
Not so much.
Yeah. Sydney, I'm going to bury this phone in your head.
Just, he had the is best. Dummy number one? Put dummy number two on the phone.
Oh, it's for you. Yeah.
What, is he mad at
us? Oh, my God. Oh, one thing you left out, Steve. Yeah, and he's punching him while he's on the phone to him. Yeah. Oh, my God. But one thing he left out was the fact that there's a second bounty hunter who's also going after these guys because he wants the payday.
It's Taggart.
John Ash.
I mean, Dorfler.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Got the whole fucking force after me, huh?
Marvin Dorfler. So and good. I saw something that said both John Goodman and John Candy were considered for that role, but it went to Ashton because he'd worked with him on Beverly Hills Cop. But that would have been interesting. I don't know if John Candy could have been as gritty as I think he needed to be. I think John Goodman maybe, but I think Ashton did a great job. Yeah,
Ashton is great in that role. And he's just the right amount of like hard ass and stupid also the same thing over and over again.
Except when they want him to fall for it or when they're trying not to get him to fall for it. And he says, I'm not falling for that again. Yeah. And he's about to get shot in the back. And then one other note is Joe Pantaleone or Pantaleano. He wanted the role of one of the goons chasing Walsh because he originally wanted the Grodin role, but they said absolutely not.
Yeah.
But then he got the perfect role of the bondsman, Eddie Moscone.
Yeah.
Got the Duke!
No kidding. This calls for a celebration. I'll get some donuts.
And to this day, I still, whenever I see a bail bonds thing, I always go, bail bonds. That's how Eddie Moscone, bail bonds.
Well,
that's how I hear it in my head.
The funny thing about that character that I noticed, when he gives De Niro's character the $1,200 that he owes him at the beginning of the movie, he pulls it out of his sock.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's $1,200 in sock money. Ew.
Sweaty Joey pants sock money.
Sock so good. Money.
The other star that is obviously not on screen, and I didn't know about this until years and years later, all the music for Midnight Run composed by Danny Elfman of Oingo Boingo.
Yeah.
Yep. And unfortunately, I think is his worst score.
It's
not because it wasn't
just nothing there.
Interesting. Yeah. There's nothing there. Exactly. It's the same repeated theme throughout the entire movie. There's nothing that really makes it stand out. And he did it different. It's a bluesy score. It's got a very Oingo Boingo feel, but it's not a very varied.
I didn't get any Oingo Boingo note out of it, really.
No, I didn't get any Oingo Boingo note whatsoever out of that. That's why I never caught on. Normally, he always has a few signature moves that you can pick up on.
Yeah. He did the end credits theme is called Try to Believe, and he sang the lead and recorded it with Oingo Boingo under another name called Mosley and the B-Men.
Interesting.
Oh, nice. Well, I didn't stick around for the end credits. I was tired.
So you had time to get to bed.
It's a long film.
It is a long film.
Yeah.
Critics liked it. Audiences loved it. Enough so that it actually resulted in a sequel. In 1994, there was a made-for-TV movie called Another Midnight Run. Christopher McDonald took over for the role of Jack Walsh.
Yeah.
And Another Midnight Run was followed by two more made-for-TV sequels, Midnight Runaround and Midnight Run for Your Life.
Oh, man, lots of, and yet, lots of drugs still, being done in Hollywood.
Yeah, and we can't get somewhere else in time made. What the f***, Hollywood?
In 2010, De Niro was actually shopping around a script, Midnight Run 2, where his Jack Walsh character would help Charles Grodin's son out of some trouble. But it went through rewrite, and it's just kind of been in development hell. They've never been able to do anything with it, but it was going to be an official sequel to Midnight Run.
God, that would have been something to see.
There's one last thing that I thought was really interesting, and who knows if it's true. It's in the, you know, the some notes and stuff that I saw, that the train scene in Flagstaff, Arizona actually prevented a kidnapping.
Really?
Because a couple of extras dressed as policemen and driving police vehicles, you know, when they get the word that the suspects have been spotted near Sedona and all the police cars take off, apparently there were two men in the process of kidnapping a woman from a coffee shop in downtown Flagstaff right as all the police cars drove by. And so they freaked out and they ran off and left the woman and fled the scene. Huh. So that's a, you know, fun little story that who knows if it's true, but I like the idea. That's what I have. I would really just recommend everybody go see this film. If you haven't seen it, it's a surprisingly good film.
Hey, everybody. Stuck in the 80s is sponsored by our good friends at HelloFresh. With HelloFresh, there's no need to make a midnight run for fast food when your fridge is already stocked and ready with healthy meals. HelloFresh is the...
Get up, bump.
Get some chorizo and eggs. Get some chorizo and eggs.
It's the special.
Yeah, I know I've had meals with HelloFresh that had chorizo in it. They're amazing. Yeah, so there you go.
Oh, there you go.
So it's fiction come to life at HelloFresh. HelloFresh is the meal kit delivery service that shops, plans, delivers step-by-step recipes and ingredients right to your doorstep. I just got my new box of food yesterday, and the meals sound amazing, especially the chicken cheddar fajitas, one of my all-time favorites. Because all my meals are made of fresh, responsibly obtained ingredients from carefully selected farms and highly rated sources, Brad and I have become loyal HelloFresh customers.
Yeah, and for me, it's all about the enjoyment of not planning dinners. I mean, come on, that's a hassle, let's face it. It's the summer, my kids are home from college, and I want to spend my free time with them, not planning meals and running back and forth to the grocery store for, oh, I forgot the tortillas. With HelloFresh, I can kick back. All the ingredients are in the fridge waiting for me when I get home.
And because the ingredients are all pre-measured, there's no waste. That's what's important to me. I have like a very small kitchen. I do not have room for like 2-gallon containers of mayonnaise. And the meals are almost ready in 30 minutes or less. And that's important to me after I make my 90-minute drive home from work every night. Last night, I made the Tex-Mex tilapia. It came with this amazing cream sauce with lime and sour cream. And it's served with couscous and green beans. Just incredible.
Mm. Well, that's really the key we forget to talk about. HelloFresh gets you out of the recipe rut, off the same old, and encourages you to cook meals you might feel are outside your comfort zone.
Once you see how easy it is, you realize it is inside your comfort zone. And because you're a listener to Stuck in the 80s, you get a special deal. Save $30 off your first order of HelloFresh by going to HelloFresh.com/Radical30 and ordering using the promo code Radical30. Easy to remember, right? It's been the promo code for HelloFresh from day one here at Stuck in the 80s. The only small change, we're asking you to go to the new URL, HelloFresh.com/Radical30, and then use the promo code Radical30.
You'll be helping out the podcast, and you'll be helping out your family.
Here's something else that always helps us all out.
The Seggies.
The magical refrain that is listener mailbag. We get a letter this week from Christian in Duluth, who is not too happy about the cracks that I made on our recent podcast about movie sequels. So clearly Christian is wrong, but we will read his letter anyway.
He could not be more right. I'm glad he wrote so Ed and Springfield didn't have to write one. Christian writes, "Wow, I have a whole lot to say for this particular email, but since I'm at work, I'll make it quick. I hope. Let me first start by saying that Steve is clearly on crack. I'll admit that Star Trek The Motion Picture was not a great film, but it's way better than you're giving it credit for. I'll even cop to the fact that it's basically a remake of the episode of the original series called The Changeling, which also features a probe called Nomad, built on Earth, sent off into deep space, and now trying to return home to meet its creator. But there are several moments in the movie which make me gasp to this day. The opening sequence, after the credits play, when the new Klingons are introduced, and then they battle the cloud, it's still one of the coolest openings I've ever seen. The scene where Scotty takes Kirk on a tour of the newly redesigned Enterprise is breathtaking in both cinematography and awesomeness for showing the audience the new ship. Okay, a side note, they spend like 20 minutes panning this. I mean, it is like beauty shot after beauty shot after beauty shot. Like, remember this part of the ship? Here's the big dish on the front. There's the red thing that glows. We don't know what it does. It's amazing. Here's the Jeffrey tubes. Oh, I've just outed myself as a nerd. Okay, let's keep moving. Many a nerd has debated which version of the Enterprise is the best-looking ship. Hands down, for me, and most folks, honestly, Kirk's new Enterprise is the most beautiful of the bunch, and this part of the film captures why. Again, they spent 20 minutes on it. Finally, I'll mention the score, which I agree is amazing. The opening music and the Klingon battle to the dreamy music played during the cloud scenes is fantastic. Don't forget Ilea's theme. Oh, so good. Okay, Steve, now you can pick apart the rest of the movie, since I know you will.
No.
Okay, your time's up. He continues. Ironically, for me, one of the worst sequels of the 80s is also a Star Trek film. Star Trek V, The Final Frontier, almost sank the franchise. It was so bad. If you haven't seen it, don't. If you have, then you already know what I'm talking about. Ick.
Let me stop right here and say that Christian could not be more right. Star Trek V, The Final Frontier is the turd in the punch bowl, but we're glad that we still talk about the franchise after this. It is one of the ones that was directed by a Shatner, I believe. And
is that the murder mystery one?
No, this is Box Half Brother.
This is the God one.
What does God need with a starship? Yeah, it's bad. Don't ask any questions.
I don't remember this one at all.
I've seen Star Trek 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. I never saw 5.
Okay, I was thinking just looking stupid. You have to see it.
No, you don't.
Want to bet?
You need it.
I have it on good authority from my close personal friend Christian in Duluth, who obviously knows a lot about movies, that I should not see it.
I'm just to paraphrase Star Trek V. You want your pain. You need your pain.
I got what I needed from it, from you. I don't have to see it now. I have my pain, and I also have my sanity. Okay.
Yeah, fair enough. Go ahead. Finish the letter.
Okay, we got just a little bit more. We're bringing it in now. Christian continues, as for sequels that should have been made, easy. The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension. Actually teased a sequel at the very end of the movie called Buckaroo Banzai Against the World Crime League. I forgot about that. Yeah. Alas, it was not to be. There were a lot of theories from budget problems, script issues, and even one theory that was never supposed to be a sequel in the first place, and that the placement of that ad at the end of the first film was just a gag on the audience. Still stuck in the 80s, Christian in Duluth.
Huh.
Yeah, I'm going to jump on here with Steve. I'm on Team Steve. God, I thought the first movie sucked. It was so boring.
You guys could not be worse.
9 hours
could not be in wronger. The ship
and 20 minutes walking is stupid. It was so bad.
No. Wrong. Wrong.
It's brutally bad.
Let him say what he needs to say.
When did you see it, Drew? Did you see it in the theaters as a kid?
Oh, I saw it in theaters.
As a kid. And you hated it.
Yeah.
It's awful. Yeah.
You're a bitter terrible. Old man at the age of 11. I feel so sorry for you.
Oh, I just had discerning tastes at the age of 11.
Maybe I'll put you next to Steve on the cruise. You guys seem to have a like-minded hatred of good things.
We could sit there under our dark cloud and mumble it all, you youngins.
Oh my! And don't even. Get-
And another thing, you know, the ice at home is a lot colder than this ice is.
I gotta say this too. Everyone knows Buckaroo Banzai is a piece of shit. I mean, I know people love this movie.
What are you doing?
It's not good. It could have been good, but it's not.
It's so fun, though. It's so quotable. It's so much fun.
It's fun like...
I can't believe
you don't like this movie?
You know how fun it is? It's fun like watching your best friend divorce his wife who you knew he never should have been with in the first place. It's that kind of fun.
What on earth are you talking about?
It's guilty fun. It's not good fun.
You know what I'm going to do to you, Steve? I'm sending you through the transporter, the first pass on Star Trek, the motion picture.
Good, because whatever happens...
And you know what they're going to get back? Ooh. It's not going to live long.
Yes. Thank you. You'll be doing me a favor.
You make me... You're making me angry, 30. Steve Spears, and that takes some doing.
There you go.
You could not be more wrong. All your taste is in your mouth, Spears.
That's actually true.
And Drew, we'll talk later.
Anyway, we love your letters. Please give us something to mock, at least mock each other with. Send them to podcast@sit80s.com. Ah, yes. The I Want My Mystery TV theme song. If that's a thing.
It is now.
You know the drill here. We play a snippet of a theme song from the 80s. If you get it right, you're entered into the drawing for a... What are we giving away? Bottle openers. I'm trying to gather some more swag so that we can mix it up a little bit maybe, but still in the process of it. Acquisition. In the meantime, pay attention. Here was the clip from our last show. That's China Beach.
Through the mirror of my mind, time after time, I see reflections of you and me. Reflections of the way life used to be.
I got it this week. I got it. And like after just 1 second, I'm like, China Beach.
That's good. I don't
know why. And I've seen like one episode of the show ever.
Dana Delaney. Dana Delaney.
There go our seven listeners. We just lost them. We'll have to work hard to get them back.
Yeah, it'll be worth it. Between her and PJ Souls, I have a real thing for women in uniform.
Not too many winners this week.
But not Star Trek uniforms, apparently.
No, because she was bald. She was bald.
I got nothing. We got to keep moving here.
Who are the winners? Oh, all right. The winners include Victoria in Big Bear, Brock in North Dakota, Brian in San Francisco, Jonathan Thompson, Canuck in Colorado, and Christine in Philly. I'll be in Big Bear this weekend, actually. It's Guy's weekend, nice. So... I'd say that we might run into Victoria, but we don't ever leave the cabin because we're playing video games all weekend. So probably not going to see Victoria.
The girl was bald.
No.
Bald, Brad. Bald.
Yeah.
Anyway, here we go.
She was bald.
Oh, God. Was that also Kirstie Alley was in that one, or was that later?
No. That's Star Trek 2.
Yeah. Okay.
She's in 2 and 3.
Nope. She's replaced in 3.
Oh, is she?
She's only in 2.
Oh, that's right.
If you were really a Trek fan, you would know. By the book.
I don't have the time for your shenanigans.
By the way,
so
we never say this, but the company that does the company that does the 80s cruise also does a Star Trek cruise, you know, every year,
which Steve would love to go on, but I'm scared to death of that.
I keep hinting, I'm like, hey,
you and Will Wheaton have a nice time.
Yeah,
you might not ever escape. Is that what you're saying, Brad? You might never leave?
No, let me just tell a brief anecdote. For one of the tiebreakers and trivia this year, we used a Star Trek question. And I'm like, this is a bad idea. There's going to be people in this room. They're going to know. They're going to have the deep lore, you know. Yep. And sure enough, we put the slide up there, and there are like 8 people lining up at the stage. You missed a bunch of stuff here. You know, there's a lot of things missing here. And that person's, and I'm like, and I had to put the hand up, and I'm like, we're not talking about this right now. Like, I couldn't handle a week with that. No, I can't do it. I mean, I respect it on a certain level. Yeah, step phasers to dorky. They're already there. You know, and don't get me wrong. I love me some Star Trek. I love the original series. Actually, I really like the animated series. I've been watching that on Amazon Prime lately, and it's pretty fun. But yeah, no, I don't. I don't need to know about, you know, the wife of the third crewman who dies in the episode with the green shirt on. And
Okay, there you go.
Go outside.
Spin the wheel, angry man.
Play with a ball or something.
Spin the wheel, angry man. Let's have a winner.
I'm going to spin it with all of my angry anger.
Angry man. The winner this week is going to be Victorian Big Bear. Hell, Drew, you can just deliver it when you're up there.
No. I'll bring it on up.
In the meantime, pay attention. Here's this week's Mystery TV theme song. If you know it,
email us at podcast@sit80s.com. Tune in next week to find out if you are a winner. Hey, that's all the time we have this week, but check back with us this coming Wednesday. Angry Man may or may not be here. No bald women, but we will have a special bonus episode. Until then, remain here, hopelessly stuck in the 80s.
Stuck in the 80s is a member of the CLNS Media Network. Special thanks to Check Battery Daily for our theme music. And don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, or the CLNS Media mobile app.
Two gallons of mayonnaise. Mayonnaise.
How many French fries would I need to go through 2 gallons of mayonnaise?
God, make me sick.